Hi everyone, I'm Charlene Habermeyer of Good Parenting Brighter Children, and this is Tidbits of Wisdom for Parents. As I've talked about the last 2 days, I've talked about the ages and stages of certain books. We've talked about the preschool age to about first grade, and then we talked second to fifth grade. Today I want to talk about some middle school books. First of all, what you have to remember is once your child hits junior high school or middle school, there's required reading lists like The K and To Kill a Mockingbird, and there's many others. So be aware of those. Ask your child's teacher for a list each year. Go in and ask them for a list of all the required reading. Now, for two reasons. Number one, you may want to read them together as a family. And number two, at this age, every book that you read, you want to make certain that you discuss, because there's usually tons and tons of things that your child can learn for every book. And again, as I've said in the past, they'll learn that the hero and the heroine and all the characters of the story, that problems don't disappear. Problems have to be solved and resolved. And that's powerful for them to learn. So let's talk about some favorites. And again, I would highly suggest going to the Read Aloud Handbook by Jim Trelease. Go through all of his anthology and pick out certain books. And by this age, what you want to do too is you want to talk to a librarian and find out different books that they would suggest for this age group. Another thing is once they get into middle school, junior high school, and even high school, it becomes more difficult to find time to read to them. One thing that I started doing is I would read to them at the supper table. And sometimes they were chapter books, and sometimes they were just short little stories that I had grabbed from Chicken Soup from the Soul, or the Reader's Digest, or even Time Magazine, or any of the other magazines out there. Anytime you want to bring in world events or history things, that's always important as well. So these are more geared towards the middle age, to junior high school or middle school age. One is called The Shrinking of Treehorn, and I'm sure you've already heard about this, but this is about a little boy, and instead of growing bigger and bigger, he's shrinking. But nobody seems to notice. His social climbing parents don't notice, his friends don't notice, the teachers at school don't notice, and so he understands that if he's going to get out of this dilemma, he has to figure it out himself. He has to solve the problem. That one is a fun one. Hatchet by Gary Paulson is a really good one. This one again is white knuckle reading. This is a story of a 13-year-old boy that gets stranded in the wilderness. It's a plane crash, and all he has to survive for 54 days is a hatchet. This too is a very powerful book. Maniac Magee by Jerry Spinelli. Okay, Maniac Magee has lost both of his parents. Oftentimes, when I read books that right away they lose both their parents, like James and the Giant Peach, on the very first paragraph, he loses both of his parents. They get eaten by a wild rhinoceros, I think in New York City. And every fairy tale just about, you know, the parents get killed or whatever, or they die or whatever. So there's a lot of stories where the child can feel very vulnerable and very much alone. But Maniac Magee is an amazing athlete. And in the book, you're reading all about his incredible athletic accomplishments. But he lives in a racially divided community. So read about how he overcomes some of these challenges and these trials and these difficulties that he is faced with, like as being, you know, basically an orphan, but has been blessed with his amazing physical and sports talent. Another one is Snowbound by Harry Mazer. And I'll tell you what happened when my second son, when he got into the sixth grade, he had a marvelous, marvelous teacher. We absolutely loved her, but she had taught high school English. So now she was coming down, she was teaching sixth graders. So she expected the same type of critical thinking skills. I think sometimes she forgot that she was dealing with sixth graders. We loved her, by the way. She was incredible. But my son was having a difficult time with being able to critically think about the stories that they were reading or the stories that he was supposed to choose and read. Okay, well, I had done some brain research, and I think I might have mentioned this, but critical thinking skills do not begin to develop in the brain until the child is 17 years old. They're just about ready to graduate. Okay, so you can do something like, and when I talk about critical thinking skills, remember, it's analyze, synthesize, and evaluate knowledge, and there's many more things that go with it. There's also compare, contrast, and you can basically teach a three-year-old to compare, contrast. So what I did is to help him is I would read every single thing that he was reading in class that was required reading. And then he got to choose books to do book reports on and so forth. So I would read those, and then when he would come home and he had all these questions that were definitely involved with critical thinking skills, I would think up some type of a situation or an experience that he had had in his life, his short little life, so that he could understand what the teacher was asking him. And I will tell you, he went from C's to A's for me just doing this very simple thing. Now, the interesting thing is he fell in love with literature, not only because of what we were doing at home, but because of this very powerful teacher. And now he has his PhD in English, and now he's a professor at a university. So all of these helps pay off for your kids. So Snowbound, and I remember when he and I were reading it, is about two teenagers that get their car stuck in this horrible blizzard. And they have to overcome cold and frostbite and running out of food and wild dogs and fighting with each other. So what do? How do they work teamwork skills to get out of this horrible situation alive? That's a powerful book. Of course, I've mentioned this before, is Where the Red Fern Grows and Summer of the Monkeys. Excellent, excellent books. There's a lot of dialogue to these books, so read them as chapter books to your kids. The Witch of Blackbird Pond. For some school districts, that is required reading. It's about a girl named Kit Taylor, and she goes to live with her Puritan aunt in Connecticut. And of course, during that time, everybody was very, very closed-minded. But Kit's lonely, and so she makes friends with a little old woman in the village named Hannah. Now the people, because Hannah doesn't do things exactly the same way, they think she's a witch. And Kit becomes guilty by association because she's friendly with her. So, and they become friends. So find out in this book what happens and what the growth that happens. Now, again, I'm going to mention the Tintin comic books, as I mentioned before, by Hervé. They're comic books, but they have over, each comic book has over 9,000 words. It's going to build your child's vocabulary. It's going to build their imagination. They're amazing, amazing comic books. So don't discount those. The Bear's House is another one. It's about a young girl whose mother's very sick, and she has to take care of all of her siblings. When she goes to school, she's made fun of and bullied because she's dirty and she smells, and she's always tired. So this is a powerful book to talk to your children about, making swift judgments. Every person that walks on the street is dealing with some type of overwhelming challenge in their lives, and it helps us to be compassionate to all of those people. Family Secrets, Five Very Important Stories by Norma Shreve. These are five very important stories because they deal with a lot of heartache that a lot of young people go through. One of them is about the death of a pet, the suicide of a neighbor, an aging grandparent, a relative going through a divorce, and cheating in school. Now, think about that. Most children, if they have pets, sooner or later, they're going to go through the death of a pet. Many children go through the divorce of their parents. The divorce rate is up to 50%. Many kids go through and watch their grandparents age and have all kinds of physical problems. Many kids nowadays, both in every grade and stage and through college, experience other kids who are cheating. So this is a powerful book to help them with that. So To Catch a Killer by George Woods, this is about a young teen who runs away and wants to just cause havoc for the widowed mother, but who runs headlong into a killer. So a lot of the books that are geared to the middle school age and the high school age deal with more adult subjects, but usually in a story form, they're ready for it. And as a parent, as you read them and as you talk to them, as you discuss them, it will help your child to grow and to help them with formulating and navigating this very challenging world that we all live in. Thank you for joining me, and I'll see you tomorrow.